thank you everyone for joining us today for the speaker series. This is our last speaker series for the year. We'll resume in January. Today we have Jennifer Bradley with us. She is the founding director of the Center for Urban Innovation at the Aspen Institute. She joined Aspen in January of this year after spending 7 years as a fellow at the Brookings Institution Metropolitan Policy Program. While at Brookings, Jennifer co-authored the Metropolitan Revolution with Bruce Katz, which she is here to talk to us about today. Jennifer has worked extensively on the challenges and opportunities of older industrial cities and has co-authored major economic turnaround strategies for Ohio and Michigan. She's also written for Newsweek, The New Republic, The Atlantic Monthly, and The Next American City. A former attorney, Jennifer co-authored Supreme Court amicus briefs in cases that affirm the constitutional powers of local governments and secured greater environmental protections, including the landmark case Massachusetts v. EPA. Jennifer has a JD, magna cum laude, from Georgetown University Law Center, a master in philosophy from Oxford University, which she gained as a Rhodes Scholar, and a BA from the University of Texas. For those of you who are seeking AICP certification maintenance, this session has been approved at CM number 31233. You can grab me afterwards or email me if you need that information. And without further ado, please help me welcome Jennifer Bradley.
Thanks very much. I really appreciate the efforts of Barry and Christina to bring me here today. And speaking in such a wonderful chamber might stoke a desire to go into local politics, because it's pretty cool to be up here. I like it. I appreciate y'all coming out. My talk this morning has 3 parts. It won't take nearly all the time that we have, so I imagine this as being a sort of a short presentation and then a much more interesting and richer conversation and dialogue, as I learn from you about some of the specific challenges of Prince George's County, and I share with you some of the things I've learned from my research and experience in metropolitan areas around the country. So first, I'll describe the challenges that we as a nation are facing, how the federal government's challenges in terms of politics, but also in terms of funding, affect this region in particular. I'll also talk about places that have really embraced the notion of acting as a metropolitan area and overcoming some of the old divisions between cities and suburbs. And finally, I'll conclude with some thoughts about what this means more specifically for the greater Washington region, and specifically how networks of actors can create the kinds of changes that will make us a more economically sustainable and innovative region. So the message of the Metropolitan Revolution is actually pretty simple. In the face of federal dysfunction and drift, cities and metropolitan areas and the networks of people who govern them are stepping up to address our most pressing challenges. We're facing a pivotal decade because even 7 years after the depth of the recession, we have still not gained enough jobs to recover what we lost during the economic downturn and to keep pace with population growth and labor market dynamics. We're still about 3 million jobs short, even though the recession was more than 7 years ago. We also need better jobs to grow wages and incomes for lower and middle class workers and reverse the troubling and decades long rise in inequality. Census data tell us that between 2000 and 2011, the number of poor and near poor people in the United States increased from 81 million to 107 million, over one-third of the total population of the country. So in the wake of the Great Recession, it's become clear that the United States, like many nations, needs a new model of growth. We've come to the limits of an economy that's built on consumption and debt. Instead of the old way of doing things, we need a next economy that focuses more on production and exports, on research and development, and on opportunity for people on all rungs of the socioeconomic ladder. Now, the challenges that our federal government has been facing over the last several years has made it perfectly clear that the federal government is not going to be the source of the economic shifts that we need. It's true that in the immediate aftermath of the Great Recession, the federal government stepped in with an important stimulus package that kept the economy from collapse and stabilized state and local governments reeling from the free fall in housing markets. But soon afterwards, as we all know, the federal government leaders were caught in the grip of dysfunctional politics. Partisanship triumphed over policy, and conflict became more valued than compromise. The federal government, bottom line, is not riding to the rescue. And this predicament is not just about partisanship, but about math. In the coming years, mandatory spending, mainly on entitlement programs and interest payments on the federal debt, will take up an ever larger share of the federal budget, crowding out so-called discretionary spending. It's kind of funny that we call it discretionary spending because this is the spending that most of us think that government does, right? Roads, schools, housing, that's the area of the federal budget that is shrinking, and it doesn't look like there's going to be any dramatic change in that downward trend anytime soon. In this particular region, as scholars like Stephen Fuller at George Mason University have pointed out repeatedly, we're doubly hit by the shifts in federal spending. Like all regions, we suffer from the crowding out of discretionary spending. Again, less money from the Department of Transportation, less money from the Department of Housing and Urban Development. But uniquely, this region feels the federal drawdown especially intensely because of the outsized impact of the federal government on our regional economy as an employer, as a purchaser of goods and services, as a buyer and renter of office space. And all of those activities, as you know, have significant follow-on effects in our retail, office, and housing markets. So in the absence of federal leadership, the Metropolitan Revolution means that smart local and metropolitan leaders aren't waiting for the federal government. Instead, they are stepping up and doing the hard work to grow more jobs and make their communities more prosperous. Now, why do we talk about metros? What's important about metropolitan areas? It's easy to overlook the incredible power of our metropolitan areas. First of all, it's just hard to say the word metropolitan over and over and over again. But we are also so accustomed to thinking of the federal government, states, and local governments. But in fact, the nation's top 100 metropolitan areas are already the engines of our economy and centers of trade and investment. They sit on just 1/8 of our land area, but they're home to 2/3 of our population, and they're responsible for 3/4 of our gross domestic product. And on all of the indicators that matter for creating this new kind of economy that I talked about, human capital, innovation, infrastructure, they account for 75, 80, 85, and even 90% of the national share. So it's not surprising that when it comes to reorienting our economy in the wake of the recession, we have to start looking at the metropolitan level. Now, day in and day out, it's very easy to focus on what divides us as a region, not just in the Washington, D.C. area, but in most regions across the country. People are very focused on what the differences are between counties or between city and suburbs. And that's especially true here because we're a multi-state region that's been deeply divided by history and political culture. But focusing on the differences and difficulties makes it too easy to forget that we have strong ties. The animation that I'm about to show you that further reinforces this notion of what is a metro uses Chicago as its example, but it still does apply to the greater Washington metropolitan area. The point remains the same, that metros are bigger than the sum of their parts. For some reason, my video is not coming on, so I can get right to what would be probably a lot more interesting to all of you, which is data on commuting patterns. This slide starts to give you a sense of how interwoven the Greater Washington region really is. Every weekday, tens of thousands of people cross county borders to go between home and work. And this doesn't count the myriad other trips they make for school, shopping, socializing, and other activities. If you look only at commuter flows into the district, you get a further sense of our independence. If we, and that the graphic here, those red lines are thick in proportion to the number of commuters that go on. If we layered on the full commuter profile, or even if we just took the three largest jurisdictions of Fairfax, Prince George's, and Montgomery County, that map would be unreadable. It would look like a bowl of spaghetti. And that reinforces our interconnections. Good schools and workforce training in one part of the region mean a strong workforce elsewhere. And the burdens of inequality of opportunity and the lost human capital that entails act as a drag on the entire region. In our book, Bruce Katz and I tell the story of seven metropolitan areas that have overcome traditional ways of working to reach across boundaries and create ecosystems in which people can flourish and the economy can grow. Denver and Los Angeles are investing in state-of-the-art transit. Northeast Ohio is making manufacturing a priority again. New York City is becoming a tech hub. Houston is helping immigrants become entrepreneurs. And Detroit is reinventing its downtown and midtown as an innovation district. I want to say a little more about two of these examples and show how metropolitan leaders are recognizing the economic and political necessity and the opportunity that comes from reaching across borders and rising to the challenge. The first story comes from Denver. So Denver is a 10-county metropolitan area, and it was able to transcend a zero-sum take on economic growth and become known for a high level of collaboration between the city and the suburbs, despite a long history of disunity and conflict. Now, as I've spoken in various regions about the Metropolitan Revolution, sometimes people look at highly collaborative regions and say, well, there's something special about that place, right? It's a one-state region, or the air is really thin in Denver, so they're all sort of like, you know, and now with medical, now with recreational marijuana, right? What are they smoking that make them get along so well? But in fact, through the 1960s and 1970s, the Denver region suffered greatly from tensions around land, tax revenue, and race. The result was a culture of mistrust and competition between the cities and its neighbors, a situation that some likened to outright war. In fact, led by suburban Denver voters, the state of Colorado passed a constitutional amendment that sharply limited the city of Denver's ability to grow through annexation. You can't find a more star- there were disputes over busing in the region that led to school buses being burnt. This is not a place that has a history of everybody getting along, but a place with this deep history of conflict between city and suburb. But then in the 1980s, a sharp downturn in the energy market caused business leaders, residents, and others to realize that the economy doesn't neatly respect municipal boundaries. Now, as a response to its own economic difficulties, the state of Colorado had cut funding for museums and cultural institutions, which were mostly located in the city of Denver. As they sought to fill the gap, museum leaders realized that most of their visitors were from the suburbs. These were not just local serving institutions, but regional ones. So they launched a collaborative effort that created a cross-municipality tax district to raise revenue for Denver's Art Museum, the Natural History Museum and Zoo, and others, with the understanding that these assets benefited the broader region. The tax was passed in 1988, and it has been renewed several times. And again, I want to point out that Colorado is one of the states that passed the Taxpayer's Bill of Rights, so-called Taxpayer's Bill of Rights, that sharply limits tax increases. So we're not talking about a population that is sort of free spending and not tax sensitive. These voters in the Denver area have voted repeatedly to tax themselves, not a lot, but to have this incremental tax so that they can sustain regional institutions. Most of the money does go to institutions in Denver. A smaller amount goes to institutions in the surrounding, arts institutions in the surrounding counties. That collaboration, most people will say that collaboration around the Scientific Cultural Facilities District led to what was the basis for creating a new kind of culture of collaboration in the region. One of the long-standing collaborations is the Metro Denver Economic Development Corporation. Leaders in Greater Denver were among the first in the nation to understand that in the global economy, the suburb of Aurora is not competing with Denver and the suburb of Littleton, but rather Denver is competing with us here in Greater Washington, with Greater Austin, Greater Houston, Greater Seattle, and metropolitan areas around the world. The Metro Denver Economic Development Corporation was created with the notion that local entities should unite to bring a company to the metropolitan area, trusting that their own communities and residents would benefit no matter where in the region the company chose to locate. I think it's a little bit similar to the mentality that might have undergirded DC's interest in the Olympic bid, understanding that wherever the facilities were, bringing in that many people and that much revenue would benefit all the corners of the region. People were able to see that with the Olympic bid, probably because, you know, it's big, right? There's a lot of different places you can put stuff. Corporate relocation is a little challenging, right? The headquarters are going to be in one jurisdiction. But if you think about the families that will come in, the dual career couples, the ability of companies to contribute to a larger ecosystem that draws on expertise that goes from the south to the north to the east to the west of the region, you can start to understand this shift in mindset. Now, prior to the efforts of the Metro Denver Economic Development Corporation, one civic leader explained that there were over 40 local economic development agencies in the region, all competing against one another for the same corporate relocation leads. Today, the group boasts that because they work collaboratively, they're actually 10 times more successful at getting corporations to relocate in the region. And they define success as the number of times they're in the top three choices for a major corporate relocation. They find themselves in the top three 10 times more often than they did before they began to act collaboratively. Now, mayors and county leaders in some of the region's communities started to wonder whether they too should start to work together on a more collaborative basis. In 1993, a handful of mayors formed the Metropolitan Mayors Caucus, a collaborative group of area mayors that now counts 40 local leaders as members. No surprise to anyone in this region that transportation got to the top of their agenda pretty quickly. Forecasters predicted that the Denver region would add almost 1 million residents by 2025, on top of the 2.5 million that were already there in 2000. Business and civic leaders feared that traffic congestion would absolutely choke the region, and they needed a new way to accommodate all of the growth that would flow into the area over the next several decades. In 2004, after a long effort filled with many reversals, voters approved a 0.4% regional sales tax increase to fund the build-out of a new transportation network, a project that's projected to cost $4.2 billion and total 122 total miles. Collaboration, as the folks in Denver will tell you, is never perfect, and it's rarely painless. But the proof that collaboration works for elected officials is that the mayors are still at it. Since 1993, the Metro Mayors Caucus has persisted. They've persisted through various disagreements. They've persisted through some real challenges with this metropolitan transportation project, including what happened right after the recession, when projected revenues plummeted and the costs of commodities spiked, and it became a lot harder to hold the coalition together to support this build-out. But because they had this tradition of trust and reciprocity and working together and learning together, and more experienced mayors calling less experienced mayors and saying, hey, is there anything I can help you with, right? They learned that to be, you know, one of the cool kids in Denver, in the Denver region, you had to be a collaborative and generous person, not somebody who threw a lot of elbows. If this video works, you'll hear from Peter Kenny, who helped establish the Metropolitan Mayors Caucus, and Denver Mayor Michael Hancock on the value of what this collaboration has brought to them. Okay.
The fact that we operate by consensus has meant that sometimes there have been some tough issues that we had to let go. It's more important to these mayors to be in collaboration, to be working together with each other, than it is to be able to attack everything that comes down the road.
It's like a sibling relationship. There are some times when you have tremendous highs and things are running great, and there are other times where you're frustrated and you don't seem to understand where the challenges exist or why they exist at all. But if you care enough, and if it's valuable enough to you, you will work on that relationship and do everything you can to always be prepared to get over those hurdles when they present themselves. There are many cities around the world thinking about how they can out-compete Denver, out-compete Los Angeles, out-compete New York. As a region, if we work together, we can compete against everyone else around the world, and we can do it well. We have a greater chance to be globally connected and globally competitive.
So Denver's regional collaboration started, as I said, with business leaders and was carried forward by elected leaders, even when, as Mayor Hancock suggested, they've sorely tested each other's patience. In other places, though, the Metropolitan Revolution is kicked off by actors in other sectors, including philanthropy. Some of you may have heard of the Detroit Grand Bargain, in which major national foundations, including the Ford, Knight, and Kresge Foundations, along with local funders, contributed millions of dollars to secure the future of the Detroit Institute of Art, while at the same time shoring up the city's pension system while the city government was in bankruptcy. But perhaps less known is the work that a group of Northeast Ohio foundations have been building over several years to help that region, which is not just one metropolitan area but four, build on its manufacturing heritage in a way that makes sense for the 21st century. So as I just said, the northeast corner of Ohio is home to four metropolitan areas, Cleveland, Akron, Youngstown, and Canton, that were hit hard by deindustrialization. During a period in which the United States as a whole lost 25% of its manufacturing jobs, these communities lost 44% of their manufacturing jobs. To turn northeast Ohio's economy around, a group of philanthropies created a new organization called the Fund for Our Economic Future. The goal of the fund was to support a new economic ecosystem in the region. Cleveland, Akron, Canton, and Youngstown had many of the raw ingredients for advanced industries, just like we do here, including great universities, major healthcare centers where ideas were developed, and the technological know-how to commercialize these ideas. What they often lacked was entrepreneurial talent and venture capital. The fund helped create new networks that connected existing strengths and linked them to people who knew how to build and invest in companies. These companies drew on the biomedical, alternative energy, flexible electronics, and water technology clusters that had historic roots in the region. While it's true that manufacturing in highly developed economies has changed dramatically, there still is a role for this sector in the United States, largely as a driver of innovation. One of the things that's interesting about the fund is there was a very egalitarian approach to how the philanthropies participated. The fund was catalyzed by the Cleveland Foundation, which put in a huge initial investment. But the foundation set up the Fund for Our Economic Future such that all of the participating philanthropies, once they met a minimum funding hurdle, which was, I think, $100,000 a year for 3 years, they all had the same weight in decisions of what the Fund for Our Economic Future would do. So this was not a case where the most money got you the most decision-making say in the collaboration. And I think one of the things that this shows is how much, I guess, the role of strategic humility. Nobody is going to want to collaborate if somebody else says, come collaborate with me and let me run the show while you show up at the meetings and do what I tell you to do. Real collaboration requires putting aside your own ego and your own specific immediate concerns for the longer term good of the region. And that's what they've seen in Northeast Ohio. The fund estimates that the grants it has made since its inception have helped add almost 17,000 jobs, $650 million in payroll, and $3.5 billion in investments in the region. These gains have gathered momentum over time. Northeast Ohio is still not where it needs to be in terms of job growth or other indicators of competitiveness, but these are strong signs of the turnaround and, again, the culture shift that's happened in Northeast Ohio. And again, we're going to roll the dice on a video.
It doesn't exist anymore where somebody sits up on the top of the mountain and tells everybody what to do. Any one of us alone is not significant enough to make a difference on a global stage. But when we come together as communities that didn't used to come together and work at this metropolitan level, we can roar with the best of the lions. And I think we're starting to see that, and we're starting to become believers, and we see more and more people joining the revolution.
So how can we take the lessons from Denver and Northeast Ohio and elsewhere to bring the Metropolitan Revolution to the greater Washington region? One of the advantages of metropolitan areas is they're not just governments. They're networks of leaders working together. Metropolitan action is, as I said, often led by actors outside of government, with elected officials following later. We talk a lot about the divisions in the region, but in fact, we do have examples of regional collaboration, whether it's similar responses from three major jurisdictions to raising the minimum wage, experiments around worker-owned cooperatives, or other regional initiatives, including the 2030 Group, Region Forward, and the new Brookings and J.P. Morgan Chase Global Cities Initiative, which is designed to boost exports from the region. These are some of the most recent examples, and many of you have either engaged in or heard of efforts from other organizations like the Council of Governments and the Board of Trade. So the question before us is, how do we build on what's happening? And I think there are three, that slide doesn't belong there. I think that there are three critical roles that we can think about how anybody in the region can see their role in sustaining and building regional cooperation. The first is convene. The second is experiment, and the third is catalyze change. Convening is one of the most underrated tools that any actor, whether that's business, government, or philanthropy, universities, any actor has. In too many metros, I think people are waiting for a hero. They're waiting for a super executive or a business billionaire, right? They want to have a Michael Bloomberg, a Bill Gates, or a Mark Zuckerberg. But it's networks, not heroes, that are the key to sustained action. If there is one thing you take away from my talk today, I hope it's a belief in the absolute necessity of networks to operate in the current economic and political context. A fascinating and growing body of research shows that as problems become more complicated, solutions require multiple minds from different sectors or perspectives. You can squander a lot of years waiting for a hero, waiting for somebody else to act, and waiting for somebody else to get the ball rolling. But you don't need a hero. You need networks. And if you're willing to look with fresh eyes, you can find or create networks through regular supported convenings. And by convening, I don't mean hundreds of people at a fancy event. I mean simply holding regular gatherings of people who can share ideas, talk about common problems, and hold each other accountable for action to solve these problems. I have been amazed at how many changes in metro after metro have been started by something as simple and felicitous as people getting together over coffee or by chance in a parking lot. Excuse me. A 2010 report by the Council on Competitiveness stated that it's not sufficient to have multiple organizations that act regionally on specific development issues. What's needed is a systems integrator that primarily focuses on the regional aspect of regional economic development, not just the specific economic challenges. Without this kind of intermediary, right, without some sort of coordinating body, making sure everybody knows what other people are doing, how they can plug into collaboration, what's happening next door in the other jurisdiction that you can learn from, it's very hard, as I say, to move things forward. Everybody's kind of head down in their own silos. But that's a pretty wonky way of thinking about it. Another way I like to think about it is, who's going to bring the donuts? That's a shorthand for who is the person that's going to organize the meeting, prepare the agenda, make sure everybody has a reason to come, make sure everybody feels like, okay, well, whatever, at least I get a donut out of it. I think the second important role in creating a metropolitan revolution in the Washington region is experimentation. By definition, doing new things means experimenting. And the thing about experiments is sometimes they work and sometimes they fail and sometimes they teach us something entirely unexpected. In the time I've been studying innovation in urban areas, it's become clear to me that innovation is inseparable from risk and inefficiency, that innovators who are working on some of the hardest urban problems are often using very new approaches, which often haven't been proven and they might not work, and that many institutions and individuals prefer to make safer bets on incremental change rather than risky bets on things that might yield good results or might fail. We can't change fact one, that innovation is inseparable from risk and inefficiency. But we can change the fact that people are really risk averse by talking quite frankly about what innovation looks like inside and outside government, and by being honest about past failures as a way to be more tolerant of future risk. In Silicon Valley, the venture capital world talks a lot about pattern recognition. The way they invest is they pick people that look more or less like previous successful, or they look people and companies that look more or less like previous people and companies that they've invested in successfully. But it takes a lot of learning and experimentation to find the pattern that's going to move you forward. It's very hard to talk about embracing risk when you're spending public money, when you are held accountable for every dime and every decision. And one of the things that I think is so valuable about these groups like mayor's caucuses or these quiet convenings of similarly situated local government actors is that they're a safe forum for people to say, here's what we're trying. It's kind of working, it's kind of not working. What are you doing? And to learn from each other there. So I know that county government may not be the place that's going to plunk down millions of dollars on an untested notion to bring people out of poverty. But I think what county government actors can do in their own way is figure out ways to connect with people, have conversations, learn, and see how you can run small experiments on what might work, whether that's on service delivery, whether that's thinking in regulation. There are resources out there for people who want to be more innovative in what they do. And I think that it's incumbent upon people to at least start the conversation about success and failure, and that not all failure is catastrophic and the end of everything, but it's a way that you learn what not to do next time. The spirit of experimentation and honesty is exemplified by Thomas Edison, who said, or at least the internet says he said, "I did not fail. I discovered 10,000 things that wouldn't work." And more poignantly, he also pointed out that many of life's failures are people who didn't realize how close to success they were when they gave up. So convening and honest experimentation are the ways to catalyze change. Let's go back and think again about how innovation happens. Here are two graphics. One describes the scientific method that many of us learned in high school, and the other shows a fairly new approach to invention called design thinking or human-centered design. And you'll see that they have some points in common. One is testing, which means not knowing how exactly things are going to work out. That's why you run the test. Learning, understanding what works and what doesn't. And documenting, which is a continuous effort to go back and try again and build on what we've learned before. And again, there is a place for this kind of work, particularly around design thinking or human-centered design in government. The federal government is thinking about human-centered design in service delivery, as are many local governments. It's a simple matter of testing different kinds of websites, right? Are people more likely to register or engage with a county service with one kind of website or another kind of website? That's not a crazy, risky scheme. That's just understanding how you might engage your constituents in helping you serve them better, learning from the people that you're trying to serve. So knowing what we know about how innovation happens, that failure and inefficiency are an inextricable part of the process, and that we have to be honest about this so that we can learn and improve, really does point the way forward for how we can bring the Metropolitan Revolution to the greater Washington region. We have to find the places that can be a repository of all that we learn so that we understand that our efforts are part of a larger endeavor to understand what works and what we need to do differently. This notion of innovation dovetails nicely with the role of metropolitan areas. Cities and metropolitan areas are becoming the leaders in our national system, precisely because they are taking on experiments. They are taking risks, making hard choices, and stepping onto the world stage. Metropolitan areas are creatively and relentlessly using the formal and informal powers that they already have, whatever they might be. This is the true spirit of the Metropolitan Revolution. Places are not waiting for the perfect conditions, right? You can't wait for the governor of Maryland and the governor of Virginia to suddenly decide that, in fact, they see the world in exactly the same way, and they're going to pull the legislatures in line and start to give the Washington metropolitan region the respect it deserves as an economic engine for both states. You could wait, and you could wait out your whole career, and meanwhile, other jurisdictions that are working with what they have will move ahead of the greater Washington area. The true spirit of the Metropolitan Revolution, as I said, is that you start with the radically imperfect conditions that you have and grapple with them as best they can. I'll close with one final animation to drive this point home.
From an early age, we are taught how our nation is supposed to work. The president, vice president, and members of Congress sit at the top. Governors and legislators run their states. The rest of us take our cues from them. While states and the federal government may be part of the Constitution, our population and economic power is actually concentrated in our metropolitan areas. It's time to rethink power in America. In this century, metros will lead and states and the federal government will follow. In cities and metros, public, private, and civic leaders are helping workers get the skills they need, investing in infrastructure and growing jobs through expanded trade and investment, the hard work necessary to renew our economy.
Thanks very much for listening to my talk, which went on somewhat longer than I expected. And now I look forward to a conversation.
So we have plenty of time for questions. I have a mic. I will bring it around. So would someone like to start off with a question for Jennifer? Yes.
Jennifer, I'm Pradeep Ganguly from the Prince George's County Economic Development Corporation. Enjoyed your presentation. Why do you think regional collaboration is not happening in Washington, D.C., number one? And number two, what evidence do you have to prove that?
So what evidence do I have to prove that it's not happening?
It's not happening, right. Because I believe there is a lot of collaboration that's happening through institutions like the Council of Governments, mm-hmm. through even the WMATA, the whole community is together, driving transportation issues. Those are very important, powerful ideas. And the entire metropolitan area is connected. Mm-hmm. So why do you think it's not happening? And what can the region do to really get to the next level of a Denver?
So I think that two things that don't sound like they can both be true are in fact true. I think that the reason we don't see more I think there is a baseline of collaboration. I think though if you look at WMATA and if you look, for example, at funding challenges, right, there's a level of baseline operational collaboration that happens. But when it comes time to think about how the region will go forward, will go from good to great, we'll think about a transportation system that is not constantly overburdened or challenged, I don't see that there is the kind of collaboration that would that would put things on a more secure footing. And I think the reason that you don't see it is nobody who is elected in Prince George's County gets any points or credit or good stuff from the voters for being a nice guy to Montgomery County. And no mayor of the District of Columbia, although I do think Mayor Bowser is talking a better game than her predecessors, gets recognized or supported for being good to people on the other side of the river or the county line. I mean, it's a real cultural and behavior change. The mayor of Denver, he's now the governor of Colorado, but John Hickenlooper used to go to ribbon cuttings in suburban jurisdictions just to say, hey, well done. You know, I represent Denver, and we are happy that you are flourishing. I think he did that because he used to be a bar owner, and he's like an unusually sociable, groovy kind of guy. But really and truly, the immediate incentives, right? Nobody gets hit for not acting regionally, right? Nobody gets in trouble for the possible benefits or good things that they leave on the table. People will get criticized if it looks like they're doing something that doesn't particularly benefit their constituencies. And we have this long history of thinking of places as competitive, right? We do sort of understand, right? If your commute is miserable because we don't have the right roads, you understand better the connections between one jurisdiction and another. But somehow when it comes to voting, when it comes to the way our politics is, when it comes to what the real incentives are, we don't have these incentives for regionalism. And I think that sometimes it's a crisis that can shake people up. This region has been incredibly blessed that we have not had to weather incredible economic crises nearly to the extent that some of our other jurisdictions, right? When the financial sector collapses and New York is hit, when energy collapses and a Denver or a Houston is hit. So there hasn't been that real push to say, we have to change what our incentives are and we have to change our behavior. So I think that's the challenge. And I frankly think that it will probably be a non-governmental entity, whether that's philanthropy or business, it will be some other entity that shakes up what the incentives are for elected officials and creates different kinds of incentives for people to behave differently across jurisdictional lines.
Hi, my name is Max Pastore. I'm in the Community Planning Division here. My question is, how exactly, I agree with most of the things that you mentioned. I think it's a wonderful presentation, and I'd love to read your book. But what exactly do you think, as planning staff, for example, you mentioned everything, many connections between ways in which government entities can work together. But aside from maybe as an urban planner making a good recommendation to a planning board, how do you propose that someone at the planning level or other departments within a jurisdiction like Prince George's County could move in this direction?
Is there a forum or a way that you could meet with your peers at whatever level, right? Not the director level necessarily, but meet with peers in other jurisdictions just informally, right? You meet a couple times a quarter. You move between the jurisdictions, so you're in Prince George's County, you host, right, a brown bag, and then Montgomery County hosts a brown bag, and then Fairfax, just so you build up that sort of shared brain. Oh, here's what, that sounds interesting. Maybe we could try that. You have an opportunity to learn more because, you know, you're the planning director of tomorrow, right? So once you create that sort of culture and you get people talking about, or not, I don't know. You know, it's these informal kinds of practices, I think, that set expectations for how people ought to start to work and behave. Now, you know, and again, that may be, it may be challenging, right? It may be difficult for you to carve out the time to go from one jurisdiction to another for a lunch bunch. So then, okay, what are your options for an after work meetup, right? We have a lot of ways that people can connect formally or informally. And that's what I'm, the fund for our economic future, which has made such a difference in the Northeast Ohio region, started when a bunch of philanthropy program officers found themselves in the Lorain Community College parking lot after they toured some great program that Lorain Community College was doing. And they said, you know, wow, all of us fund this? I didn't know that. So did you guys hear about what's going on in Cuyahoga County? And they just started talking to each other. And it was one program officer who took it to his boss at the Cleveland Foundation and said, you know, I think we got something here. I think if we all just started to share our docket sheet, we could think differently. I don't know what might arise if you guys have planning staff under 30 in the National Capital Region have a meetup. Nothing's going to happen if you don't do anything. So, you know, just try some stuff.
Thank you. Good morning. My name's Larry Hintz, and I'm with the Economic Development Corporation. I have two basic questions. One, will a copy of your presentation be available that we can have emailed to us? That's one.
That will depend on the tech guys, but yeah, I think so. And it's also being videotaped.
Oh, okay, excellent. Number two, there's something that actually concerns me a little bit. I loved your wonderful examples in Ohio and in Denver, but what I thought I heard was it took trauma to bring about the change. Do you have any wonderful examples that trauma was not introduced into the environment before the change came about? Because if not, then what I'm seducing from that is it will, what it's really going to take is not this wonderful philanthropist or some wonderful entity. It's going to take trauma to be introduced, and I hope that's wrong.
You raise an excellent question. Most of the examples in the book are from places that acted differently when things broke down. You know, we talk about Los Angeles, their transit move, which is not one of the examples in this presentation, but Los Angeles had a sort of run-of-the-mill problem, right? Their traffic problem is catastrophic to them, but it's not, you know, it wasn't an earthquake. And they rallied around, again, a new area-wide transportation tax. And then the mayor of Los Angeles created a national coalition of Republican and Democratic mayors, along with labor, along with business, to change TIFIA funding so that it could be used a little more flexibly. So I think you don't always need a crisis. It, oddly enough, makes it a lot easier for people to change their behavior. And I think, though, that if we correctly understood the impact of the federal government shifts, that would put a certain urgency into conversations in the Washington region. So we might want to talk not about, wow, we are in the throes of a crisis and it's terrible. We might want to start modeling and costing out some of the federal government shifts. You know, what does it look like in Montgomery County when their commercial vacancy rate is sky high because the GAO is not renting that space? Do we think that's going to get any better anytime soon? Let's model that out. What does it look like? I think the numbers might alarm people and get them to think, wow, that let's not get there. How do we shift what it is? There has to be that incentive for people to change their behavior. And what my co-author Bruce Katz and I hope is that by talking to places, we will have a better answer to questions like yours, and we'll say, okay, you can endure the trauma or you can try to get out ahead of it. Because in an uncertain world, in a global economy, the way things are now are not the way they're going to be in 5, 10, 15, much less 20 years. In the 1920s, Detroit had the reputation that Silicon Valley has today. 50 years later, Detroit was already seen as a place of great struggle, right? When I've talked to people in Seattle, what actually keeps them up at night is they're fat and happy right now, but they know that they won't always be. So what do you do to build it in so that it's a smoother transition rather than a really nasty wake-up call? And so maybe this region or Seattle or in Austin might be the one place that figures out how to do preventive medicine at the metropolitan level rather than waiting for a crash, right? Or another place that's got an energy sector dependent economy or something like that. But there's always something that we can't anticipate. So how do we think about how to be resilient in the face of that? And in this region, it's not a secret, right? It's what's happening with the federal government and that monoculture economy that's built up around it. And it's not going to be pretty. So how do we try to manage the ugly?
Hi, I'm Dan Janicek from Transportation. And I'll speak to that. I think it's a good example because I can give you an example of transit planning, for instance. When Metro came along, a lot of coordination. Metro's moving into different counties out from D.C. And it wasn't until last year where counties like Montgomery County and the District of Columbia actually met to talk about transit cooperation. Now, they have the Council of Governments because federal money's sort of funded through there. But still, they didn't get together at a local level and talk. And I think because D.C.'s now got such a transportation problem, each county is trying to think about transit, but how do they connect? So D.C. is building a streetcar system, but we are really, we're right at the beginning levels of planning to connect to it. So transportation is a big, probably one that would do it. And then new transportation systems, not only a crisis, but there's the idea of brand new types of transportation systems like hypertubes or driverless cars, mm-hmm. which may be a big wake-up call for the region. And we really will have to get together at a very local level. Montgomery County is going to have to talk directly to the district. We're going to have to talk to Virginia. We're going to have to all talk to each other and meet. But that meeting last year between the DOTs hadn't happened in like 15 or 20 years. So,
and I think that's a good point, is that some of this, again, it's the difference between day-to-day cooperation at the operational level to keep the lights on, and then the larger leadership-driven collaboration about, oh, wow, yeah, what happens when driverless cars, like they're not gonna just come to a halt on Georgia Avenue when they hit a jurisdictional line. All right, so what do we got here? And those are political level decisions. There's a technical element to them, but fundamentally those are values-based decisions. And if you have a sort of a collaboration that goes all the way through on technical, on the values and political situations, you're just better equipped to handle this. And I'm not saying that every other jurisdiction has this all worked out. Most places don't. What we're trying to do is tell people, start with where you are and start now.
Bill Washburn, Community Planning Division. You know, over the course of more than 40 years of living in this area and working in this area, I've watched the metro system start as one of the most advanced systems in the country. And now it's limping because the two states and the district can't figure out a regional funding formula to keep Metro going. There's also the issue of jobs imbalance in this region. And it's one reason why we see such a huge flow of commuters coming from Prince George's County in Southern Maryland into Virginia. And I guess the third one is the housing piece itself. And the fact that we actually have not just the Washington region, but Baltimore sitting cheek by jowl. And I'm wondering what are the prospects, if any, you see for those two regions beginning to talk? Because at one time, I think the Census Bureau tried to push a conception of a combined metropolitan statistical area, but it didn't gain any traction with the decision makers. And I'm wondering if you see any prospects for beginning to grapple with these issues at a metropolitan level. I used to represent DC Office of Planning on the Transportation Planning Board a number of years ago. And as you said, there was a baseline of collaboration, but when it comes to funding, the collaboration stops at the jurisdiction lines. Do you see any promises or possibilities for our breaking out of that?
I think that the place to start would be with Metro funding, because I think that's the place where you can get the most people around the table to exert outside pressure. The challenge is that the important people who need to weigh in on this decision don't live and work in the Washington region, right? And there's all kinds of issues that pretty much any state has with its largest metropolitan area. A lot of times legislators don't feel like a large metropolitan area already gets too much attention, and they don't recognize that really this is the economic engine that they need to support. But I think that if you can start the conversation around transportation and specifically around Metro, which really is a jewel of the region that we are sadly neglecting, that's a good place to start. I would save the Baltimore conversation for later. That's pretty advanced. Barry was asking why Baltimore wasn't part of the metropolitan region, and I don't know how the census exactly makes their calculations based on commuting patterns, but I think it would probably be best for us right now to get strong with the region we have before we start to build bridges with the Baltimore region. And there's a lot of reasons why I think politically that would be challenging. But one of the things that I find happens is that people, when we start to talk about metropolitan areas, they bring that out to the largest problem, right? When I started in this field in the 90s, people were still talking about city-county consolidation as a way to solve some of the challenges that cities were having then. City-county consolidation has happened like 5 times in the United States. If you start with city-county consolidation, you're just gonna burn everybody out on the difficult politics. So what if you start on city-county collaboration on a specific issue, right? It's all about the incentives. What do people have incentives to come to the table and deal with? The recognized challenges of the metro system, I think, are that. And I think once you have collaboration that's worked and you've established that, nobody dies if they collaborate, then you can start to move on issues. I think people are also ripe for housing because, again, they understand the connections between transportation and housing. But Metro is a very concrete thing that can focus people's attention right now. So that's where I would start. And, I think you're going to see in some time horizon Baltimore and the Washington Metro kind of grow together, particularly as Baltimore builds out its tech sector with a lot of the stuff with Johns Hopkins. And then you've got College Park, which is sort of facing both communities, and I think that'll be really exciting. I don't think we're there now because I don't think there's a particularly concrete way to, there's nothing concrete that we can all agree to work together on.
Thank you for being here today.
Sure.
Two questions for you. The first is when you talked about governments and their not being able to look, I guess, forward, would it help to have, let's say, for example, in Prince George's County's government, to have a team looking at future projects or future things and staying out of the day-to-day and then bringing that information back to their director? The second question is, concerned citizens like myself that want to work in partnership and use my use skill sets that they have to work in partnership with government, big business in the community. How can that relationship grow, and how can we develop a framework for that?
So in terms of having a team that's not involved in the day-to-day, but that is looking at future possibilities of collaboration, sort of your R&D, your kind of intellectual R&D team, that's a great idea. The way, though, that most places fund that is through a significant grant from a philanthropy, right? So you have the Bloomberg Philanthropy's innovation teams, which unfortunately work just with cities, right? Because Mayor Bloomberg's mindset is city and not, understandably, right? The New York metro region is huge. So Rockefeller Foundation does these chief resilience officers. I would love to recommend that, yes, every local government should have the sort of vision squad, the people who are able to do the issue spotting, to work collaboratively. I don't know where the funding for that comes, particularly as operational budgets are, always being squished. So that's a real rock and a hard place question. The places that I have seen it done successfully is where there's been some nice outside source of money. In the UK, it's funded by the central level government. Again, here in the United States, it's generally a trusted philanthropy kind of embeds or pays the cost of an officer like that. So I don't know quite how, I don't know enough about the finances of any local government, but I think that the financial decision makers would say sure, but there's a long list of other positions that we probably have to fill before that. So then you have to think, okay, how do we then encourage that notion of issue spotting and forward thinking as a kind of day-to-day thing in people's jobs, and figure out how to reward it so that whoever has a notion has a little, maybe not a full staff position, but maybe there's a little pot of money to pay for a little bit of time on people's behalf to start to do these issue spotting and visioning exercises. And if you think about the sort of concerned citizens and partnership and how that relationship grows, maybe there is some sort of informal advisory board where people from the private sector who have this experience in the visioning, the seeing around corners, working with user experience, bringing these innovative processes into government in a kind of, a training session, a pro bono, here's how you find out more. I think that would be a very positive way to engage the capacities of the different sectors in a way that's realistic and respectful of cost constraints. As a person who's never worked actually in a local government, I am very aware that sometimes the recommendations that come from a Brookings institution or an Aspen Institute just don't meet reality tests. Mm-hmm. So I'm trying to figure out how to make that great idea seem operational and doable rather than, oh, we could never do that because who's got, the line item for salary, fringe, and the whole shebang in the budget.
Jennifer, I want to ask you a quick question. Sure. And I want to take you off topic a little bit. I know you've done a lot of work in some of the newer areas of the sharing economy and micro-entrepreneurship. And I know we have some people in the room who are working on our zoning ordinance rewrite project. And because those are emerging shifts that we're seeing in the economy and planners with zoning are, regulatory, I'm wondering if you can speak a little bit about how those newer kind of economies want to be regulated. Maybe not under the 20th century model.
Right. I think that we're at a really interesting point with companies like Uber and Airbnb and Lyft. And those are the ones that are best known, and they have the money to be really aggressive. But there are also a lot of micro-entrepreneurs. There's food truck entrepreneurs. There was a piece, I don't know if you saw it, in the Post business section on Sunday. I'm old-fashioned. I still get the paper. So I still refer to articles coming out on a particular day of the week rather than when they're published online. But it was about licensure and hair braiding. Those are all relevant issues as we start to see that what used to look like an employer and an official company now looks like an app. And what used to look like a contractor now looks like a freelancer, and somebody is an Uber driver and a restaurant, a restaurant entrepreneur, and has a very different economic portfolio for themselves. When a lot of these companies first appeared on the scene, their approach to regulation was none, right? They wanted no regulation because how are they any different than you letting a friend sleep on your couch? And how are they any different than you giving somebody a ride to the airport? Well, when you have a $4 billion valuation, you look a little different. So I think that these companies are willing to engage with regulators in a new way, but what they don't necessarily want is it to be a sort of head-to-head cage match with the incumbent industry. So how do we think, I think that gives us an opportunity to think a little more broadly about what is regulation for? Is regulation, right, there's some things we can agree on, protection of health and safety, some level of security, not static, but some level of security and predictability around property values. Again, some understanding of what kind of neighborhood you live in and what kind of activities are going to go on there. Is regulation designed to protect incumbent businesses, or is it not? And how do we debate that, and how do we think about that? And how do we think about this in terms of making sure that as we change regulations, we're not treating companies like Uber very, very differently than we would treat an informal jitney service, right? That's run, you know, or Vanpool, or somebody who's thinking about entrepreneurship that way. That to me is what's most interesting about these new business forms. You know, people talk a lot about the sharing economy as if it just happened. This is not exactly accurate, but it's a great tweet, and so I go ahead and say it sometimes. You know, when rich people do it, we call it the sharing economy. When poor people did it, we called it the black market economy, or, you know, at best, the informal economy. People have been sharing their stuff and providing things formally and informally for a long time. So as we open up the conversation, let's just make sure that we are taking into account all the different forms and not making it legal if you come from Silicon Valley and illegal if you're local and have been doing it for a long time. And if you can make a case that it's the same kind of thing, then let's support it. And let's also look at paths to formality and support, right? So rather than a regulation or a licensing question or a zoning question being an opportunity to say no, what if that was a way to sort of uncover entrepreneurial energy and entrepreneurial interest and say, you know, we keep getting people wanting to do thing X. Do we have resources in the county that could support them on a regulated or a licensed path to doing X? Are there community college resources that could help them? Right, a lot of people's engagement with government could be used as a kind of a data collection exercise. Wow, people really want to know how to start a business. Okay, do you know what I mean? So I think that's what the sharing economy, that's the larger conversation to have, even as we're trying to do the hard work of figuring out, okay, what do we want to do with Airbnb? How do we balance out the economic opportunity it creates for the property owner or the leaseholder versus the safety of the neighbors? Let's also think about, okay, so obviously people want to have these side streams of income, and are there ways that we can put county resources to support those in a way that maximizes, again, safety and gets people on, you know, a couple higher rungs on the economic ladder?
Okay. We have time for a couple more questions. I'm going to come over here to Larissa.
Hello, my name is Larissa Ferre. I'm one of the commissioners of Town of Avo Marlboro, and I'm also an architect. So thank you very much. I enjoyed your presentation a lot, and I appreciate you reminding us that it's a great idea to collaborate with neighbors to solve mutual problems. And what really bothered me about what I heard, and I want to share it with everybody, I heard the message that, well, last 10 years, the federal government sounds like didn't do their job. And because of that, we need kind of take things in our own hand. That's what I heard, and I want some clarification on that. Well, it might be right, but at the same time, we cannot survive without federal government. We don't want to, the country, we don't want to fall into despair and lose federal government because the strong and competent federal government, I think it's important for the our safety and safety of our children and the future. So my question is, well, why don't just improve the relationship with federal government and keep them more accountable through the elected officials? For example, I have personally met representative in Maryland's state and communicated with him about certain issues, and he wrote to me thank you letter, thank you so much, because that's very few people even bother to give their feedback about what's going on. And that's true, we all have, I mean, I hope we all participate in the election. We have our elected representative in the federal government. Why don't we have more conversations with them as well, not only as a citizen of certain places we live, but as a government entity, what they do to solve the problems, to make things better, because government has the responsibility. They have programs about economic development, they have programs for disaster relief, they have programs for the environment, and they're all very, very valuable. They coordinate efforts, their collaboration, the one you advocating us to implement and increase, but the federal government already coordinating all those efforts. Why won't we shake them up, make them to report to us what they do and how we can make their work better? Because my other point is, at least my impression, that a lot of officials in federal government, according to the public news, they have still thinking of 30 years ago. They have the same mentality, the same approach to international affairs, and maybe the same approach to internal problems. So what's the problem? Are they just stuck, or they have limited education, or they border themselves, travel all over the world and study a little bit? So the middle advisors, it sounds like they're absolutely not doing their jobs. So we need to shake up our elected officials to look over their stuff and their competence, because it looks like the United States is falling behind in a lot of things, education, you know, political issues, and so forth. So in my third observation, thank you for your attention, is, I mean, you're suggesting meetings and talkings and researches. Well, I've been observing all this, and Christine is my witness. That's what we did in town of Upper Marlboro. We did a bunch of studies, application for grant. We spent a number of hours, and we got $35,000 from the government, but we probably spent $50,000 to get the $30,000. So there's a lot of paperwork running, requirements, reports. But at the same time, look at the town where we live. I live here for 4 years, and it looks like the environment in this town is getting bad, it's getting declined. Look at this schoolhouse pond. It's all trashed up. It's getting shallower. You all have walks around it every day. It looks like there's not enough garbage cans. So to make my speech short, I mean, that's great to have a talk in coffee shops and in this area, but what about to have some kind of community cleanup day so people know who they are actually doing something for the environment, for a place they live or place they work?
So I think that the...
Thank you.
Sure. I think that your the range of your remarks speaks to the challenge that we're facing. I think, and this is particularly true when I speak to audiences in the Washington region where the federal government does have such a huge power, Sometimes I think that when we think of the federal government, we mean the Johnson administration, and it, leaving aside the foreign policy adventures, right? But the domestic agenda of the Johnson administration, and that they're somewhere locked in a basement, and if that we could just find them and unlock the basement, the federal government would go back to being like it's supposed to be, which was the social justice-oriented activist stance that they had in the Johnson administration. And that was even carried over to some extent to the Nixon administration. Richard Nixon couldn't make it through the Democratic primary today, but he's the gentleman who had a lot of faults, but gave us the EPA, right? That's a Nixon administration endeavor. So I think we have this notion of what the federal government really should be, and we believe that what it's been for the last however many decades is an aberration of some sort, that that's not the real federal government. The federal government that we have is the federal government that we have. And I think that it's quite useful to have high aspirations for the federal government. But again, even if everybody started to get along tomorrow, there are financial constraints on the federal government that I don't see going away unless we have such a revolution in our approach to taxes in this country. And I don't see that revolution as happening. So yes, it's important to hold the federal government to high standards, but when they don't live up to those high standards, we cannot ourselves say, oh, okay, well, we'll just wait until they do. There is a certain amount of tension. There are things that the federal government does that no other level of government can do. Unfortunately, the federal government is also pulling back and away from some of the things that they've done so well. So that's the reality. And you can lose a lot of time hoping for that reality to change, right? Hoping for there to be a huge infusion of federal money in affordable housing. In the meantime, there are workforce level housing needs and genuine affordable housing needs that are not going to be met. So what do you do? And so my answer is, in this imperfect system that we have, it's up to the metropolitan areas, I think, to restore people's faith in government. The degree of alienation and cynicism about government, and you know, when people say government, they generally mean the federal government, right? That's what we mean when we say government or big government. I think if metropolitan areas and county government and city government show people what government can do and can be and how it can act, that's the way to create a higher standard, so that people won't think of the federal government as a joke, and they won't think of the debates as, you know, fun, entertaining, fight night, Twitter fodder, but they'll really say, guys, you know, let's be serious, because we have seen that government can work and do good things. And so why is it that my county executive or my state legislature is a stand-up place where I understand things, and then, you know, what happens to you guys when you hit the federal level? So I think it's this notion of dealing with where we are, and, you know, as the president says, be the change you want to see in the world, right? How do you create a higher standard for government? It's by showing people what it can do at its best.
Hi, I'm Dan Smith, one of the few people, I think, doesn't work for the county government here, but with nonprofit, the Anacostia Watershed Society. Do you have any examples of how maybe environmental collaboration, cooperation, or planning across jurisdictions has led to some of this, metropolitan revolution? I think there's a huge need in this area, huge opportunities, mm-hmm. and some huge things we're going to have missed opportunities if we don't do that.
I think that there's no place that I know where this has been planning led, but I think it's been planning supported. So if you look at Detroit, for example, before there was the Grand Bargain and the Woodward Corridor and Saving the Art, there was the Detroit Riverfront Project. And that pulled in a lot of different actors to do cleanup and to sort of restore the riverfront in Detroit to the people. And it's a huge attraction for people throughout the region. People who were not necessarily comfortable coming into Detroit from the suburbs found that the waterfront was a powerful attraction. Again, the Cleveland area has a really nice balance between understanding farmland preservation and what that means for strengthening the built urban core and built urban environment. So I think that those are the ways that you can, again, start to build collaboration and trust by holding something up as a kind of regional asset or regional jewel. Watersheds, as we know, are multi-jurisdictional, right? They don't, the Anacostia doesn't just stop itself or change somehow its chemical composition when it hits a border. So I think these are spaces, and if you can lift up that work and show that there are regional assets and that they can bring regional interest in, that could be a stepping stone for broader work. And some of it is just in the communicating, right? So if that's a success story, or is on the way to being a success story, or could be a success story, then what's next? What do we do with this partnership that we've built up around the Anacostia? Do we turn it into other kinds of environmental concerns? Do we turn it into planning concerns? How do we build on the successes that we have? And usually, again, these tangible things that people can sort of see and touch and enjoy and appreciate are good places to start.
Thank you, Jennifer.
Thank you. Thank you guys for taking the time. You've been one of my better audiences, really engaged. I appreciate it.